A very good morning and welcome to the 32nd meeting of the Social Justice and the Social Security Committee. We have no apologies. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda item 5 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Our next agenda item is an evidence session on the Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council Bill, SEAC Bill for short. This is a member's bill which was introduced by Mark Griffin, MSP, on the 8th of June 2023, and it is currently at stage one. We have already heard from four panels and the Scottish Government, and today I welcome Mark Griffin, MSP, and I also welcome Neil Stewart, Senior Clerk, Non-Government Bills Unit, and Ailey Callender, Senior Solicitor, Legal Services Office, Scottish Parliament. So thank you very much for joining us today. And Mark, I believe you would like to make a short opening statement.
Yep. Thanks, Convener. I really appreciate your welcome here today and the 5 weeks now of evidence the committee's taken, so really appreciate the in-depth look that you're taking at this proposed bill. And if I can, Convener, maybe just go into some of the motivation that lies behind the bill and give the committee perhaps a flavour of why I'm here in the first place. The first thinking behind this bill was back when we were in the middle of the pandemic and thinking particularly about key workers who caught COVID through the course of their work, some of those who developed long COVID and haven't been able to go back to work at all. And the motivation was really started by that and thinking about how we could get long COVID prescribed for those key workers who didn't have the luxury of being able to self-isolate, how we could give them support through the newly devolved employment injuries assistance that was about to be delivered by the Scottish Government. But when I looked deeper into the Industrial Injuries Disablement Benefit Scheme that already existed, you know, the failings in that current system became much more apparent to me, and it was clear that it was more than just people with long COVID who were in desperate need of support. And you will have heard evidence of a whole range of people who are being missed out and left behind by that current system. You'll have heard evidence about the gendered nature of the entitlement as it stands, that only 7% of applicants through the prescribed route are women. So, you know, this is a social security entitlement that essentially fails half of the population. It's also outdated in terms of the types of employment that it covers. It doesn't reflect modern workplaces in the 21st century. It essentially supports men and male-dominated heavy industry, which existed in the 60s and 70s. You've heard compelling evidence from trade unions and workers' representatives about the types of people who are being missed out. You know, firefighters, shift workers, care workers, footballers with head injuries, and like I say, women completely ignored by the current system. And that's why, taking a step back from the long COVID aspect, I felt that a whole systems approach was more appropriate and more important. And that's how I've come to this point today. And I think, as well as that, the timing of when we're introducing this bill and this council is really important too, because the government, the parliament will need concrete evidence of what the benefit will look like and the council in place to advise on modernising that benefit before it's fully devolved and delivered. The government's agency agreements with the DWP say that they must have a business case, they must have a plan in place for how they will deliver this new benefit by the end of March 2025. So, you know, that is not very far away. That's less than a year and a half. So the Parliament, the Government, really needs to get on with the job of delivering what that new entitlement will look like. The Cabinet Secretary welcomed the wealth of work that we have collated last week in our evidence session. There has been a lot of work has gone into this bill and the consultation that went before it. And I would say that for me, there is really no need to reinvent the wheel here. There is a ready-made proposal that the government could adopt, because I think there is a real risk that running up to that March 2025 deadline, the government could end up duplicating a lot of this work, having to do it in a hurry and probably costing itself a lot more money. And the Cabinet Secretary and I have got an outstanding meeting that we need to put in the diary. But when we meet, what I will say to the Cabinet Secretary is there is a line in this bill which relates specifically to commencement. I'm more than happy to discuss and negotiate with the government when they feel the best date for commencement is, whether in fact they would prefer to commence this bill by regulations and leave that entirely within the gift of government to choose that date. So I'm absolutely open to the government on timing, but like I said, I think we are fast running out of time. The Cabinet Secretary also said that she felt an advisory council was perhaps one piece of the jigsaw of employment injuries assistance, but I actually fundamentally disagree with that. I don't think this council would be one piece of the jigsaw. This council would be the body of expertise, the lived experience that would design the jigsaw itself. They would be advising government on designing it and putting it together, not just a single piece. Now, you'll see from the bill that it has the capacity to commission its own independent research. The membership criteria is clear. It draws on medical expertise, workers and their representatives, and crucially, those with lived experience of employment injuries and illnesses. And it has a balance of employers and employees on that council. But finally, Convener, the crucial point in this is I think that it delivers the government's aspiration to be a fair work nation. The Fair Work Convention support this proposal because one of the key planks of that ambition to be a fair work nation is effective voice, to give workers effective voice. So that's to give workers, those with lived experience, those with the real in-depth knowledge of injuries and illnesses at work, their seat at the table, to give them their voice in designing this new benefit, making sure it can be what it could and should look like, fit for modern Scotland, 21st century workplaces and the illnesses and injuries that workers are getting today and into the future. But I'm looking forward to the questions that I'm going to get today. So thanks for your time, Convener.
No, thanks very much, Mark. And I'm going to now invite members to ask questions. And I, first of all, I'm going to bring in Ros McCall. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming along, and good morning, Mark. You've already alluded to this reasonably succinctly in your opening statement, but I'm wanting to talk about timing, if I may. As you're aware, the Scottish Government wrote to the committee back on the 6th of November saying it will shortly consult on EIA, but we're still some years away from its delivery. The Cabinet Secretary couldn't give a lead in time from the consultation to the benefit introduction, and she didn't give a timescale. So you have really sort of highlighted that time is running out. So on that timescale, could you elaborate a little bit more on why should this bill be supported in the absence of any policy on EIA or a commitment to a firm timetable for its introduction and its reform? And why not wait until the consultation?
Well, I mean, there's a bit of a frustration on my side that I feel like I've been waiting on this consultation since 2019. I think Parliament and this committee have been told almost on an annual basis that the committee will the consultation will come this year. I think the government told the committee it would come this year, and then the Cabinet Secretary said last week potentially next year. So we have been waiting and waiting and waiting, and that there has a frustration in there. But I think the key point when it comes to introducing this bill in the absence of the developed policy of what employment injuries assistance looks like is actually crucial, because you would want to have the expertise of that council. You would want to have the medical expertise, the trade union expertise, but more importantly, the lived experience, those who have been injured or become ill because of their work and aren't being supported by the current system. You want them to be in place to advise on the development of the policy, on the development of the new entitlement to have them in place in advance of the government taking over full responsibility for this power, for this entitlement. But on timescale, you know, the government have their agency agreement with the DWP. The DWP have said there will be no extension to that. They have been fairly firm and robust with the government that the government must take over responsibility for this benefit by the end of March 2026. They need to have a business plan in place as per the agency agreements by the end of March 2025. So that's less than a year and a half away, where the government need to have fully set out their plans, their business plan, for how they will transfer the existing caseload into the new benefit and what the new benefit will look like in terms of levels of payment and entitlement and everything else. So for me, it's really important that we get the expertise in place before that happens to advise on how all of that is done. And, you know, we're less than a year and a half away from that point, so we're running out of time.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that.
Okay. I'm going to bring in Bob Doris. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. Mr Griffin, I know there's a frustration over the timing of when the Scottish Government bring forward its detailed proposals, and I understand and appreciate that, but it's about getting it right, of course. Dr Sally Witcher, last week at committee, former head of SCOS, said in relation to going now with proposals such as your own, Mr Griffin said, we will not know what expertise we will need to scrutinise that would be any new benefit put in place and ensure that it is designed and delivered as effectively as possible. So, Dr Witcher, I'm not taking it out of context, I don't think I am, Mr Griffin, was suggesting that the timing was too early in relation to going now with this. And the second thing I would add, just for your reflections, Mr Griffin, to help the committee come to its deliberation conclusions, is that the Cabinet Secretary indicated that there would be an advisory panel in place with experts on it to help give advice on what any new benefit entitlement would look like. So you'll see the committee's wrestling about whether or not this is needed at this time.
Yep, I did see the comments from Sally Witcher last week. I think she welcomed the proposal and caveated that with her thinking on whether the timing was right. For me, you know, there's two aspects to the council. There's the council being there in advance and being able to give advice to the government on the creation of the entitlement, but then the further role that they would have in terms of scrutinising regulations that the government brought forward, but commissioning research into emerging illnesses and injuries. Now, when we come to employment, injuries and assistance, I think the membership criteria that I've set out in the proposed bill covers what an employment injuries assistance would look like. And also, sorry, what was your second? Oh, sorry, on the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to creating an advisory group. Now, that is a welcome development. It is a step in the right direction. But what it is an advisory group which will create recommendations like we have had in the past. So, I mean, we had DACBEG, which was an advisory group set up in the past, set up and then disbanded before its recommendations have been implemented. You know, DACBEG were a working group that were set up to advise on this, amongst other benefits, and they recommended that this council be set up, but that recommendation has never been accepted or advanced before they were disbanded. So I have a concern that while a working group is a step in the right direction, it's not set up by statute. The group can be disbanded just as easily as it's set up. The membership criteria isn't set out in primary legislation, so it's not as defined as Parliament might like it to be. It potentially wouldn't be gender balanced. There is a whole range of a whole range of questions about what that working group could or couldn't look like that we really don't have clarity as a Parliament. But crucially, it wouldn't be protected. It wouldn't be independent of government and set up by statute. It could be disbanded as easily as it was created.
Can I just check, because this would be, I mean, there's two aspects to this. I think, Mr Griffin, one is about whether there's a value in an advisory group advising government ahead of a new benefit being finalised, launched and rolled out, and the recommendations, the expert recommendations to government about who qualifies for any new benefit. Those are two separate things. So if I could separate those for a wee second, Mr Griffin, given all the caveats you've said about you would want some reassurance over what any government advisory group would look like, would you accept that it would be possible for the Scottish Government to draw on expertise from across the country and across all areas required to inform what any new employment injuries assistance would look like, that it doesn't require, I know your preference would be setting this up in statute, but it wouldn't require that to fulfil that function?
It is possible, but not preferable, I think, because it wouldn't have its independence from government. You know, some of the advisers that it could potentially recruit to that advisory group would be employed by the public sector, be employed on, not directly but indirectly, by the government. I think it's much more preferable to have an independent body set up by statute that, you know, has no fear or favour and can make recommendations on that basis, and can't be disbanded at the whims of government if it doesn't like the answers that it gets. But also, there's been nothing stopping the government having this in place for the last 4 years. It seems a bit strange that the government are only now coming forward with a potential for a working group at the point of an introduction of a members' bill in a similar area.
I think the thing I would say finally, Mr Griffin, is I think we heard last week that the reason for some of the delay was the prioritisation of the Scottish Child Payment in this Parliament. That led to slippage elsewhere, and I suspect it's being introduced now because you mentioned the tight timetables that government's on, so now would actually be the time to do it. But I take on board the points you've made, Mr Griffin.
I did hear the Cabinet Secretary's comments about Scottish Child Payment, but you know, since the introduction of Scottish Child Payment, from the very first announcement, the consultation on employment injuries assistance has been promised almost on an annual basis since that announcement. So, you know, the work on Scottish Child Payment hasn't come out of the blue. That has been ongoing and has been known by government, but they've still promised almost on an annual basis to start the consultation. So it's not as if the government promised the consultation would arrive before Scottish Child Payment and then had to push everything back. They have still promised the consultation almost on an annual basis while Scottish Child Payment has been in place and been developed.
Thank you. Our committee will, of course, pursue that. Thanks, Mr Griffin.
Thanks very much. And I just quickly want to touch upon a point that you mentioned earlier when Ros Bacall was asking questions, and it's in relation to the the Minister for Disabled People, Health and Work, and that they noted the importance of keeping on track, and a formal request would be required if agency agreement for IIDB were to be extended further. I'm just wondering whether you have any further additional information on that, based on what you stated. Thanks.
Yeah, I'm only going on the agency agreements that are in place between the government and the DWP, and the DWP's assertion that they wouldn't countenance a further delay, that they were looking for essentially the 2026 deadline as a hard deadline that they didn't have capacity to go beyond.
Okay. Well, thanks for confirming that. I'm now going to invite Marie McNair in. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Mr Griffin, I respect your long-standing interest in this matter, and your bill obviously raises a number of kind of wider issues that need to be considered. Before I get to kind of the theme that committee want to cover, and obviously given your long-standing interest in industrial injuries, can I ask you about something that Ian Tasker had said during his evidence? And he'd said regarding political decisions and eligibility, that has been part of the problem over the years, as excessive governments have just ignored industrial injuries benefits. I just wanted to know kind of why do you think UK governments for decades have refused to allow women and men injured in the workplace to seek benefit?
I think that has been partly a failure of government, of, you know, my own party and other parties. It has absolutely been a failure of government, but also a failure of the way Industrial Injuries Advisory Council has been set up. they work at the behest of the DWP, which is why I thought it was really important in this proposal to give the Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council their own independent research commissioning function, so that they weren't at the behest of government or civil service as to what they could or couldn't do. They would have that independent power to go out and commission the research and make the argument almost undeniable when it came to make their recommendations to government, and hopefully that there would be a much stronger relationship between this Scottish Council and a more responsive Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament to addressing what I think are the undeniable calls for change in the system as it is devolved.
If the next general election, you know, Labour are returned, do you think that your party would make reforms, obviously, because, you know, the additional consequentials would come over and obviously it would help us reform or benefit?
I don't know what the UK Parliament, the UK Labour manifesto will contain. All I can say is that, you know, we're devolving the entitlement to Scotland, and in that devolution I would want to see a much stronger advisory council in place with its own research power to make that argument. Like you say, if there were changes at a UK level, that would lead to consequentials, but we've already seen from the Scottish Fiscal Commission that they are projecting that the budget for this entitlement is due to fall, so there is headroom created in the budget that has been transferred. So there is capacity to make changes, I think, on entitlement specifically, but, you know, focus on purely on the Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament aspect of that. I hope that this new council would have a better relationship to start with, but also the greater powers it has on commissioning research independently would make a difference.
Thanks for that. Covering your bill now, I mean, obviously, a number of my questions you've already kind of covered. The bill would prevent SCOS from considering a draft regulation on EIA. Does the proposed membership of SEAC include enough expertise on the wider social security issues to replace SCOS scrutiny role entirely?
Yeah, so when we were drafting the legislation, I mean, I'm sure the committee will see that a lot of the legislation is a mirror image of the legislation that was put in place that created SCOS. So a lot of the membership criteria are the same. I think, off the top of my head, there's maybe section 97 of the bill that set up SCOS. So there is a mirror image of a lot of the membership requirements. So I hope that, you know, the government, in seeing the strength of SCOS and their expertise and experience, will appreciate that a lot of the similar expertise and experience will also be recruited into the SEAC membership. And again, it was to mirror the current situation where, at a UK level, IAC scrutinised regulations on industrial injuries, disability benefit, and the Social Security Advisory Council, I think it's called, at a UK level, do so for all other social security regulations. So it's a mirror of what we have at place at a UK level.
Sure. Close the Gap said that membership should be gender balanced. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely, and that is why I think it's in the schedule of the bill where it is linked to the Gender Recognition of Public Boards Scotland Act, so that would achieve the gender balance requirements that I think are really crucially important to start the work on addressing the failures of the current system when it comes to women.
Given that, do you kind of anticipate any strain trying to achieve gender balance, obviously securing the right expertise?
That's why I think we've given flexibility in the membership. We've said that there should be a range between 6 and 12 to hopefully give the council the flexibility it needs to recruit the range of membership while maintaining, you know, the balance on gender, maintaining the balance between employers and employed members of the council, with the membership criteria that we've set out. That I think that gives the flexibility to recruit the level of expertise that we need. And I think you'll have seen from, you know, 5 weeks of evidence that there are really, really passionate people with a lot of expertise that are desperate to get round the table and start doing the work. So I don't think there'll be a shortage of volunteers.
Thanks for that. Really appreciate your answers.
Thanks very much. So just on that, I'm just going to come in quickly in terms of, you know, you touched upon the membership, and that it's a fairly small membership given the wide variety of issues that you're dealing with, or that they're dealing with. And in terms of how you would expect to get that level of expertise given some of the scientific issues and also, you know, social security issues there. How would you be able to kind of widen that net, if you like?
Well, like I said, we've got between a membership of being between 6 and 12. The current UK Advisory Council, I think, is 17. So marginally, two-thirds the size of the UK Advisory Council, potentially. But we wouldn't expect, you know, every single individual category of membership to be held by an individual. There will be crossover. There will be people there with a range of skills and expertise, multiple areas of expertise. I think that looking at a council of 12, that you could quite comfortably realise the membership conditions of the council without going beyond that number and potentially being over costly when it comes to the proportion of the benefit spend that they would be scrutinising. I think when you start to go bigger than that, then you potentially look at costs running a bit higher than you would want them to.
Okay, thanks. And just touching upon the wider role that SEAC would play, and witnesses that came forward had suggested that SEAC could have a more preventative role to help improve, obviously, occupational health within the workplace. So to what extent is this possible, given that a statutory body could not be given functions that relate to reserved areas as well?
Yeah, so this was one area that, you know, we were really careful of when it came to reserved issues and devolved issues. You know, I absolutely would not want to see this piece of legislation if it was passed at the Supreme Court. I don't plan on going there in my lifetime. So I was really careful to make sure that, you know, the preventative role is reserved. It's with HSE, so not straying into that territory whatsoever. But that being said, you know, the work it would do would have a preventative role in itself. The research that it would commission would fill data gaps that we have currently in Scotland, which, you know, filling those data gaps, filling those knowledge gaps, improving awareness and education would have a preventative role in itself. It's mandated to have at least one public meeting every year where it would publicise the work of the council and improve the education of it, which I think, again, improves prevention. But also, if this council was making recommendations that were accepted by government, that was increasing entitlement and, you know, the budget for employment injuries assistance is demand-led, I would imagine that if a government saw that demand-led budget creeping up and up and up, then they would look into that to see why and probably take some preventative action of their own. So while it doesn't, like you say, because of issues around reservation, have any direct impact on preventative work, I think a lot of the work that it would do in and of itself would lead to greater prevention of illness and injury in the workplace.
Thanks very much, Mark. I'm going to bring in Bob Doris. Thanks.
Thanks. I did have a supplementary on the convener's questions, but you said something in your answer there, which is, can I just ask a really brief question on your answer there just for a bit of clarity? Mr. Griffin mentioned about increasing entitlement and recommendations. By that, do you mean increasing, changing the eligibility criteria to increase entitlement, or do you mean scientific and wider evidence to say that the threshold has been met, that certain conditions and certain categories of the workforce should receive the benefit? So is it about changing the eligibility criteria, or is it about that scientific and wider expert evidence to say the eligibility criteria and threshold has been met?
Yeah, sorry, I was talking about prescription, and essentially if the council was making a recommendation on prescribing certain illnesses, right, or injuries in certain occupations, and government then decided to accept that recommendation and implement, and that led to a bigger call on the budget, then government might look at that to say, OK, perhaps there is a bit of preventative work to do in say the fire service or the health service or whichever area that that spend has been driven by.
That wasn't the focus of my questions when that came up, Mr. Griffin. I think other members will question later on about whether or not, without changing eligibility criteria, we really address the fundamental flaws with the IAC, but that's for others to explore in their evidence. I was really interested in the preventative role. I have to say, convener, I'm a little bit conflicted, not about the preventative role, but about whether this is the right bill at the right time. But there's lots of really good things within it, Mr. Griffin, that I don't think should be lost. And one thing that's come out to me is that gap of data, granular data at a workplace level. I don't think the Health and Safety Executive is sufficient in how they go about that. The RIDDOR reporting is not the only way that can be done. There's a gap there, and it does overlap between devolved and reserved responsibilities. And of course, trade unions are important, occupational health is important, and others are important as well. So this committee will have to make recommendations, and this is the essence of my supplementary, I suppose. I would like those recommendations not to be bound by constitutional debates. So if the information tells us the preventative role is in relation to aspects of employment law or health and safety, would any expert body feel empowered to make recommendations on the reserve matters as well? So I'd like to know your views on that, but also whether or not you think this committee should recommend for completeness that employment law and health and safety law should simply be devolved to this Parliament, because that would have all those powers sitting in the one place. So I'd like to know the members' views on those things.
Yep. Well, I mean, you'll know from the vote that we had in Parliament in, I think, November, that there is no disagreement between the member and I on devolving employment law, but we're looking specifically at this bill that we are given.
So can I just check on that? So for completeness, it would be helpful for this bill if employment law was also devolved to this place. So that's good that you've agreed with that. What about health and safety?
No, I don't think I've maybe explained myself properly. I'm saying I don't disagree with the need for devolving employment law. But what I was going on to say is that I don't think it's necessarily applicable to this bill in itself. On the wider aspect, than yes, but specifically on this bill, we're setting up a council which would scrutinise regulations on employment injuries assistance. So while they have a specific power within the bill to work with others, and I think the HSE and their evidence have said that, you know, they regularly work with Scottish Government and public bodies in Scotland and would have that.
Cutting across, but it's worth noting, Mr Griffin, I really do apologise for doing that, but the Health and Safety Executive wouldn't come and give oral evidence to this committee. Their written evidence, I think, is pretty incomplete and insubstantial, but it does talk about their pretty close working relationship with IAC. So it would need to have a pretty close working relationship with SEAC or whatever was put place in Scotland, but it's pretty much silent on that and won't give a view on that. So I'm a bit dissatisfied about that. But this line of questioning is about not about criteria and eligibility for a new benefit. It's about the preventative work. And if research and evidence at a granular level was to find a compelling preventative argument to change employment law or to change health and safety legislation, shouldn't this body have the power to make pretty strong recommendations in relation to that? And wouldn't it be helpful if those powers sat in the Scottish Parliament? I think that's the essence of my questioning.
For me, there is a specific power within this piece of legislation that gives the Council the power to work with other bodies as they see fit, which includes HSE. HSE themselves, well, they didn't give oral evidence, and their written evidence have said that they regularly work with Scottish Government and other public bodies in Scotland, so it seems they are capable and willing of to work with this new Council. They have observer status on IAC. Now, it would be open to members to propose an amendment at stage two, which we could look at as to whether HSE had observer status on this council too. But that aside, there is already the power within this bill for the council to work with others, which includes HSE. But they don't have a preventative role in and of itself as
I'm a bit confused, Mr. Griffin.
I'll ask
one more time, then I won't pursue it further, because maybe we're just coming across purposes, which is not intentional from my part. Anybody, so I want to capture something really good within this legislation that's proposed, Mr Griffin, and that is, irrespective of whether it's your bill or whether it's what the Scottish Government brings forward instead of your bill, if we identify as a Parliament, as a statutory body, deficiencies within the workplace where we could be doing more to prevent ill health, disease at a workplace level, and that overlaps with employment law and overlaps with health and safety legislation, do you think this body should be able to make recommendations on employment law and on health and safety legislation? And I won't ask again about whether that should sit within this Parliament, because I don't think we were kind of getting anywhere on that. Should it be making recommendations on those two things?
As it stands, as the bill is set up, it doesn't have the power to interfere on preventative work because of the reservations.
But can it make recommendations, though?
I mean, anybody can make recommendations, but whether it's in its power to do so, I think I would argue that, again, I've been very clear about staying within the bounds of the devolution settlement and, like I say, not wanting this piece of legislation to end up at the Supreme Court, that this is something where we've been very focused on the powers within the Scottish Parliament. That's not to say that we don't agree on the need for further devolution, which could lead to greater enhancements at health and safety at work, but I'm operating within the constraints that, you know, the presiding officer and the Parliament set me when it comes to drafting this piece of legislation.
I won't test the convener's patience any further. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Bob. I'm now going to invite Paul O'Keenan. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to Mr Griffin. I'm keen to understand the opportunity for reform which exists, which we've already covered this morning. We've had the Scottish Government here last week in terms of the Cabinet Secretary arguing that the bill will not deliver a reform benefit. So actually, you know, and I think, again, we've heard some of that already, but can the member explain how setting up SEAC would address the stakeholders who we've heard from as well, their desire for reform?
Yep. So this bill in and of itself will not deliver a reform benefit. It's up to the government to deliver the reform benefit. But if you are the Scottish Government looking at the devolution of what is an inherently unfair and discriminatory system and creating that new benefit that you would hope would be in line with the progressive ambitions of this Parliament when it comes to devolution, you would want the people round the table advising you on that new benefit to be those with lived experience, those who have been left behind and discriminated against by the current system. And I think that's where, you know, a lot of the stakeholders who are desperate for change are putting their argument. And the best thing to do would be to set up that council, have it independent of government, get those people round the table advising government on the setup of the new benefit. Like I said, we are running out of time. There is less than a year and a half for the government to put their plans in place for this new entitlement. And the best thing to do, in my mind, is to have those experts, those with lived experience in place, designing that new benefit from the get-go. Now, like I say, the Cabinet Secretary said last week that she felt an advisory council, you know, was a piece of the jigsaw of EIA, but for me that's completely wrong. The advisory council designs the jigsaw, they set it up, they make sure that it best meets the needs of the people of Scotland who are becoming ill or injured through the course of their work.
Thank you very much for that. And I wonder, in terms of the stakeholder engagement you have had thus far, in terms of your preparation of the bill, we've heard evidence here. I mean, they have been very clear about the importance of their lived experience and the range and breadth and depth of that. I mean, I don't know if you want to say any more about the sorts of areas that would contribute to that, you know, that expert advice going into that creation of the benefit.
I mean, there's a whole range of occupations who have been ignored, and there's really strong evidence out there already that, you know, the FBU have presented on cancers and firefighters who are getting them because of exposure to contaminants, getting cancer at a much earlier age than the rest of the population. There's clear evidence that shift workers, particularly female shift workers, have a higher incidence of breast cancer and other cancers. There are there is a strong campaign supported cross-party on footballers with head injuries. There is a whole range of workers with asbestos who have been completely ignored by the current system and the strange rules that Unity have worked with asbestos itself, you know, ignoring the workers who work every day in buildings with asbestos, ignoring those who, you know, handled the overalls that were covered in asbestos dust. You know, there is a whole swathe of workers who have become ill, injured and died as a result of just going to their work that have been completely ignored for the last 50, 60 years. And the devolution of this entitlement is a real opportunity to start addressing that. But we only do that if we get those people with lived experience in the room, on this council, independent of government, making those recommendations and setting up the benefit from the get-go.
Thank you. And I wonder if we can just return to the comparison between a non-statutory working group and what you have proposed, because obviously government last week said we're going to have this non-statutory working group, etc. And I know in the exchanges with Mr Doris we started to touch on some of that. But I think it would be useful for us to just hear your comparison of what the two would look like and why essentially, and I know you touched on it, but the statutory footing is so important in terms of actually, you know, ensuring that the recommendations can be implemented and acted upon.
Yeah, I mean, one of the key points is that it's set up in statute, you know, it's primary legislation passed by this Parliament, protects the status of the body. If they make a recommendation that a government, you know, a government of any colour disagrees with, and you know, disagrees with strongly, they are not at risk of being disbanded. A working group set up by government can be disbanded just as easily as it was created. And we've seen working groups in the past set up and disbanded without seeing the recommendations implemented. So for me, that is a really crucial part, that we set out in statute that this body is independent of government, that we are clear on the membership requirements set out in statute, again, not subject to change at the whim of government, and that they can't just be ignored. But there's also the aspect of who would be on that council. That is likely to be made up by some public sector workers, some workers who are employed in directly or indirectly by government, and they might feel that they are curtailed in a government working group by their employment status. And I think it's important to give them the protection of their independence created by Parliament through statutory legislation.
So your contention is that if the government are able to abolish at whim a working group, you will lose the richness of that diversity from certainly the trade unions, and we've heard them speak about the importance of having that worker representation. Also the point I think Marie McNair made around gender balance and having that, you know, locked in terms of the Representation on Public Boards Act. So essentially what you're saying is without that statutory underpinning, there's a much looser, you know, and I suppose in terms of the expertise and the experts that might sit on that, rather than having just the choice of the government, actually it's about laying that out in statute so that there's a clear path to who is there.
Yeah, absolutely. You have that clear, defined membership. And you also have, I think you've also got to look at the comparator with the UK system. The UK system, while, as I said to Marie McNair, the relationship and the setup of IAC isn't ideal, it still at least has worker voices on it. It has a body set up by primary legislation which can't be disbanded, which has workers' voices, and we have devolved a system to the Scottish Parliament where, you know, normally we devolve to be closer to decision makers, to be closer to people it affects, to be more progressive, but we've devolved a benefit entitlement and cut out lived experience. We've cut out workers' involvement, we've cut out trade union involvement by not establishing a council. So for me, that's a big gap that we need to fill. Whether we do it now or whether we do it later, you know, let's not reinvent the wheel. Like I said in my opening statement, as the Cabinet Secretary said, there's a lot of work has been done into this proposal. We could end up in a situation where the government replicates this at pace, right up to the deadline, and cost itself a lot more money in doing so, rather than just working together on this bill when it comes to stage two to get something we can all agree on.
Thank you. Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Now I'm going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Convener, and you're maybe not surprised I'm going to ask you about finances, as I usually do. So, to start with the financial memorandum, we have figures in concerning, well, research and IT are the two areas I'm kind of particularly interested in. IT and website set up 50,000, and then maintenance going forward 7,000 a year, research 30,000 a year, and I just wonder if all of these figures look a little bit low to me. Can you say anything about them and why you think they're the right ones?
Yep. When it comes to the financial memorandum, you know, the estimates that have been providing it, and you know, that's what they are financial estimates. They are based on bodies which have been created of a similar size and nature. You know, there's detailed work to, when we look at the IT costs, to show that, you know, the similar set-up costs for the patient commissioner. And I think that those figures stand up. I think there's been an element of confusion, if I could say, when it comes to, you know, IT setup costs in previous evidence sessions. You know, we are not talking about the IT setup costs for the benefit itself. We are not talking about, you know, the costs of transferring from paper and microfiche from huge warehouses down south up here. We are purely talking about the IT setup costs of a very small body with, you know, as I've set out, three or four members of staff. So I think when it comes to the IT cost, looking at comparators with other bodies that have been set up of a similar size, I think the IT cost estimate are absolutely robust, and I would stand by those. When it comes to research, that's a different area. But again, we have provided three separate examples of costs of research that other bodies have done in a similar area. But I think, if I can check the financial memorandum, yep. We have said specifically when it comes to finances, the nature and length of a research commission would be a matter for the council, so it could vary significantly. So I appreciate that, that while we have given three examples and the £30,000 figure relates closely to the three examples that we have given, that as the council is set up, as they set their own work plan, that, like I said in the financial memorandum, that could vary significantly. Now, it was good to hear the Cabinet Secretary last week saying that she thought perhaps £30,000 was too low, so it does seem like the government are open to the negotiation that would inevitably take place. The council would independently set their work plan and their research plan and then negotiate with government on what their budget would be. So that is the likely place where we'd end up. But like I say, it's good that the government seem open to that discussion on what they would view as an adequate and realistic research budget. Like I say, we have referenced and sourced the cost of similar bodies, but you know, clearly caveated that by saying it could vary significantly.
Because you wouldn't get an awful lot of research for £30,000, would you?
Well, it would depend what research they were carrying out. They could be looking at existing research in the field. You know, when it comes to looking at the issue of cancers in firefighters, there is already a strong body of research that the FBU have commissioned. So when it came to that particular body of work, they could be relying on existing research. And that would more than cover the cost of interrogating existing research. But like I say, I go back to the point that I made earlier, that the council independently would set its own research and work plan and negotiate with government on that basis as to what they felt their costs in a particular year would be.
Okay. Now, I accept the point that the financial memorandum and your figures only have to cover this particular bill. However, I'm just wondering, if the council was set up, and we've already mentioned about how women, I think we all agree that you know, women are being disadvantaged in the present system, industrial injuries like firemen with cancer, stress for teachers, all of these kind of things are missed out at the moment. But what happens if the council set up recommends that all of these things should be included, but then there's no money in the Scottish budget to pay any extra benefit? We're still stuck with whatever it is, 84 million or thereabouts. What would happen then?
Well, the council purely makes recommendations. You know, they don't control the Scottish Government's budget. It's for the Scottish Government to decide whether to accept the recommendations or not, and then for government to decide whether to find that funding. You know, governments make choices on priorities every single day of the week, and it would be up to the government of the day to decide whether to accept the recommendations or not, based on costs. This council purely would investigate, commission the research and make recommendations. It is then for government to decide on those and how they were funded.
But there certainly was an expectation from the trade unions who we had here that, you know, there would be an expansion. This almost inevitably leads to an expansion of the benefits paid. I mean, is there any point having the council if it makes a range of recommendations and the government says no to them?
Well, no, but similarly with SCOS. SCOS are there to make recommendations on social security provisions, and it's for government to accept them or not on the basis of the cost. You will have seen SCOS make recommendations that the government have refused on the basis of cost. Now, there is already a headroom in the budget. The Scottish Fiscal Commission have said that the budget is likely to fall from 78 million to 74 million, I think, if I'm remembering rightly. And I think that is because of the current system, the way that it's set up. Like I said, it essentially supports men who worked in heavy industry in the 60s and 70s. Now, as those men are sadly passing away, entitlement is dropping off. The budget is falling year on year because of that, and because we haven't updated the list of prescription or entitlement, that won't change. The budget will continue falling. So there is, in my mind, already headroom in the budget to make changes. But like I say, it's not for this council to decide on government budget. You know, they have no role in setting the government's annual budget. The government of the day will make decisions based on the argument the council make, and also political pressure, which trade unions and other campaigning organisations will apply every single year when it comes to budget day, that their priorities should be reflected over any other. So it will be for the government of the day, and this council can't tie the hands of whichever government when it comes to setting their budget.
Okay, and again, on the question of timing of setting all of this up, I mean, the government seems clear that stage one, which, and you've said rightly that stage one is coming along quite soon, but stage one will be purely transferring the payment from the UK level to the Scottish level. So there'll be no changes for the first few years, and then after a few years, maybe the Scottish system will change. So if that's the timescale we're looking at, you know, is it worth spending money on a council at this point?
Well, the Cabinet Secretary said last week that she didn't know what the new benefit would look like. Now, if the Cabinet Secretary herself doesn't know what the new benefit will look like, then I would say that the government needs expert advice, which is what this council does, and puts that council in place in advance of devolution. I think that council, with the expertise and lived experience that it has, is best placed to tell government what the new benefit should look like. You know, we are not just devolving industrial injuries disablement benefit and introducing it like for like. The government are changing the name, and I would expect...
But is it not just the case that to start with, for the first few years, it will only be the name that's changed?
That will be the choice of government. You know, the government can choose to change, the government can choose not to change. That's not for anyone else other than government or parliament to decide.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Katie Clarke in. Thank you.
Thank you. And it's proposed that the council is given powers to request information from a very wide range of organisations. So could you perhaps justify why such extensive information-seeking powers are being proposed?
Yep, so we modelled the information requiring powers on the Freedom of Information Scotland Act. So we felt that that was a good place to start. And also listed some other organisations as well. I think it's really important to give this council essentially the teeth to go after the information, to fill the data gaps that currently exist to support the work that it would do. But that being said, I would hope that it would have good working relationships with the types of organisations that are contained within Freedom of Information Scotland Act to get that information voluntarily, and that they wouldn't have to go down in the route of requiring information. But that was the thinking initially behind the provisions in the bill that was modelled on that act that we felt worked well. But I know the member has work in that field, and that might be updated at some point in the future.
Indeed, I lodged a final proposal this morning, but that obviously is a different discussion. But in the Freedom of Information legislation, there's the ability to designate further bodies. So would you envisage that there would be provision to perhaps extend bodies with experience?
Yeah, thinking about that in advance, that the landscape of public bodies changes with almost on a yearly basis with every government. So we have put regulating making powers within the bill so that ministers can designate additional bodies as they are created.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
OK, thank you. I am now going to invite in Bob Doris, and that will be the last of the set of questions.
It's just some technical questions, Mr Griffin, just to kind of complete what scrutiny. So SEAC is established as a body corporate with a duty to audit its own accounts. That's what's proposed. I couldn't have told you this, but in researching for your piece of legislation, this is apparently unusual for advisory NDPBs. So other bodies don't do it that way. This body will. Why the difference?
So again, it goes back to how the legislation was drafted, and I guess the closest comparator when we were drafting the legislation was the creation of SCOS. So we mirrored a lot of the provisions that applied to the creation of SCOS. But I appreciate that since this has been introduced, that there is legislation proposed to change the status of SCOS, that SCOS have given evidence that perhaps this is overly burdensome. So open to amendment at stage two, if we get that far, on changing some of the reporting requirements, given the new body of evidence that we have received from SCOS.
I think if I ask you that question again, Mr Griffin, I'm going to avoid the acronym and just say non-departmental public bodies. It's much easier to say than putting those letters together. Thank you for putting that on the record. The bill includes minimum timescales for scrutiny and requirements to consult regardless of whether regulations are substantial or are minor and technical. So I'm just wondering why you think that's proportionate. SCOS doesn't have these requirements on it. Those minimum times are 4 months, a 1 month lead in, and 3 months after that as well. And I'm also conscious we're not quite sure what the new benefit is going to look like. We're not sure what the eligibility criteria is going to look like. We're not even sure what types of regulations might be seen from time to time. We're kind of all a little bit in the dark, Mr. Griffin. So why those minimum requirements? Might it be quite burdensome if any new body has to move fleet of foot and quickly? You mentioned earlier that you try to mirror this as much as possible in SCOS. SCOS does it a different way. So I'm just wondering why there's a difference there.
Yeah, this was reflecting some of the SCOS evidence that have been given to previous committees where they have, I don't know if complained is the right word, but maybe raised concerns about the notice periods that they get from government and the time they have to report on regulations. And it was reflecting on some of the early work of SCOS that perhaps a greater lead-in time was needed when it comes to that. But we have been careful to make sure that we include a provision in the legislation that says that if any regulation made by government is considered to be urgent, that it waives the responsibility to consult or the timescales that are in place. So felt that as drafted, it was kind of reflecting some of the issues with the working practice that SCOS had raised, but still given the flexibility to be, like you say, fleet of foot if the government felt that regulations needed to be introduced on an urgent basis.
Okay, I think that's helpful. Just finally, the member's clearly mentioned SCOS a lot, and I completely understand why Mr Griffin would do that. I think they would consider themselves fiercely independent of government as well. And earlier in my line of question, I tried to separate out a non-statutory advisory group advising government in relation to what the new benefits should look like, and a statutory body that would then give recommendations to government about which groups, which individuals, which conditions would qualify for that benefit. One suggestion we heard was SCOS doesn't have the expertise to do this, but a subgroup contained within SCOS could have that, and that might have the advantage of not setting up a new body. It would be statutory, it would be independent, but it might be less costly. Is that something you've given consideration to?
We did, but then in considering the nature of the entitlement that we're looking at, it is to give workers who have been injured or become ill at their work support through the social security system. And I think it's important that those workers, those with lived experience, are given permanence, that they have a statutory underpinning, that they can't simply be disbanded as a subcommittee of SCOS whenever they felt the need, that they were protected.
If that was put in statute, though, I suppose my frustration is I want to give this piece of legislation a good will, convener, but I kind of need to make sure that I am looking at all the potential options of the best way to do this, and this is one of those potential options. So I'm just wondering if that subgroup was specified, entrenched in statute, independent and could operate, might that not your desired outcome, but might that be one outcome that would still be progressive?
It would take primary legislation in the same way that this bill would, so you know, a lot longer and pushing a lot closer up to the deadline that the government have to take over responsibility for this benefit. But you would need to see a mirror of the provisions of this bill in terms of the membership, in terms of the balance of employers and employees, and making sure that has lived experience. I guess you're still looking at primary legislation to implement that. I'm not sure how much financial savings there would be from creating a subgroup with essentially the same purpose and function, and probably take a longer time to get to the same point where we could potentially be in passing this legislation.
That's surely helpful, Convener. I'm not sure either. I'm just trying to make sure the committee is looking at all the potential options, and clearly we're presented with one specific option, but I really appreciate the evidence you've given this morning.
Okay, so that now concludes the evidence session, and I thank you all for attending. The committee's next step will be to report to the Scottish Parliament in the coming weeks. So I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for the set-up of the next agenda item. Thank you. Okay. Welcome back. Next this morning is the consideration of an affirmative statutory instrument, the Social Security Information Sharing Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. I welcome to the meeting Shirley Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice. I also welcome her officials, Camilo Arredondo, Solicitor, and Kelly Donohoe, Cross-Cutting Benefits Policy Official, Scottish Government. So thank you for joining us today. And following this evidence session, the committee will be invited in the upcoming agenda items to consider a motion to approve the instrument. I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. So I'm now going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement. Thank you.
Thanks very much and good morning, Convener. The primary focus of Social Security Scotland is to ensure people receive the assistance they are entitled to, putting the person first and treating them with fairness, dignity and respect, in line with the key principles of the Social Security Scotland Charter. However, the Scottish Government recognises that in undertaking this role, Social Security Scotland engages with some of the most vulnerable people in Scotland. Inevitably, this will lead to instances where it becomes apparent that a person may be at risk of harm, and to adequately support people in this situation, we must have a clear and robust process in place. As such, and in keeping with our commitment to support the well-being of the people we engage with, a public consultation launched in March 2022 seeking views on creating a specific legal gateway for Social Security Scotland to make referrals concerning risk of harm to the relevant authorities. The consultation responses demonstrated overall support for this proposal. It is important to make a distinction between cases where a person may be at risk of harm and those where there is an immediate threat or risk to life. Situations where immediate threat or endangerment to life are observed are reported to Police Scotland under the Common Law Duty of Care. These regulations instead cover the sharing of information where a person is at risk of harm, with harm depending on the sharing variously being defined to include significant neglect, physical, mental or emotional harm, or being likely to cause self-harm. Child and adult protection services within local authorities are governed by legislation which is underpinned by Scottish Government National Guidance for Child Protection and a Code of Practice for Adult Support and Protection. These allow referrals to be made by government agencies and third sector organisations who engage with vulnerable people and who may have cause to refer concerns of harm. In July 2022, the Code of Practice was updated to include Social Security Scotland as one of those agencies, recognising the agency as a key partner with a role to play in supporting vulnerable people. Such referrals where a risk of harm has been identified are currently being made by Social Security Scotland under an interim process while these regulations are being considered. The agency has a safeguarding team staffed by qualified health and social care professionals who review all concerns raised and, where appropriate, make referrals using a gateway in health legislation. However, this legislation only covers sharing related to harm to physical and mental and does not cover financial abuse. These regulations now enable sharing of information relating to financial abuse where this caused harm. Furthermore, for the purposes of transparency, I consider it appropriate to create a bespoke and explicit legal gateway to cover safeguarding referrals from the agency. Additionally, during the course of drafting, officials identified that where a person is an adult with incapacity under the Adults with Incapacity Scotland Act 2000 and has a power of attorney, a legal guardian or is subject to an appropriate order, the public guardian has authority to investigate concerns of financial or property abuse. Drafting therefore includes referrals to the Office of the Public Guardian where this is suspected. The process of preparing these regulations has involved significant engagement with relevant parties, including the Information Commissioner's Office, local authorities, health and social care officials, information governance policy leads, social work leads and data protection officials. The regulations make provision for Social Security Scotland to only make referrals of concern of a risk of harm. This is to ensure no interference with the investigating powers or decision-making process of local authorities. It remains for local authorities to make risk assessments and to evaluate additional help required by the individual. For the avoidance of doubt, the sharing provided for by these regulations will ensure the referral will have no impact on the assessment of a person's application for assistance. Only information relevant to the risk of harm observed will be shared. Consent from the individual being referred will be sought in most instances, but I have included provisions to refer cases where consent cannot reasonably be obtained. No information concerning a referral of harm will be held in a person's file relating to their application for assistance, and the referral will be stored in a separate restricted access file in line with data protection laws. Convener, the aim of these regulations is to support vulnerable people who are identified as being at risk of harm by referring them to the appropriate authority for help and support. This, as I'm sure the committee will agree, is a positive action for the people who need it most.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So I'm now going to move on to questions, and our questions will be directed to you, but you are, of course, welcome to invite any official to respond, should you wish to do so. So I'm going to invite Ros McCollin. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. What training and guidance is in place to ensure that data sharing is proportionate? And just for clarity, I know you've alluded to this in your opening statement, but can you give us a more detailed idea of what you're thinking proportionate is? Thank you.
Thank you. So all staff have mandatory data protection training, which is refreshed annually. Staff training on identifying vulnerable people at risk of harm has been delivered alongside guidance and a process which ensures staff can raise concerns quickly and effectively. All concerns identified are discussed with a line manager and then forward to the safeguarding team, which I mentioned in my opening remarks. That dedicated safeguarding team, as I said, is comprised of experienced professionals who are responsible for considering and reporting the referrals to the appropriate authority. This team is overseen by the Deputy Director for Health and Social Care and the Chief Medical Advisor, so that experience and knowledge is very much informs that proportionality of information sharing. So this is a process which has many levels, checks and balances to it to ensure that all staff are trained, but the information is shared sensitively within the agency and particularly towards the safeguarding team, which is then comprised of a great deal of experience.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'm now going to invite Bob Dorison.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I suspect these regulations are designed to have real quality changes of practice which make a difference to vulnerable individuals. So what kind of changes in practice do you envisage may happen, and how would that be monitored?
So at present, the concerns of harm, as I mentioned in my original remarks, are being referred to local authorities through the 1978 Act, but that doesn't cover, as I mentioned, scenarios of financial harm or financial abuse. So that's a very important aspect that this develops. But as well as filling those gaps, it absolutely maintains our commitment to support some of the most vulnerable people that we engage with. So our ability to put this in a very clear, transparent fashion is also very important, even though we have had an interim process in place. On the aspects about it being monitored, this is very, very important, given the sensitivity of the information and the importance that the agency and government overall have in ensuring we're dealing with this sensitively, appropriately, and thoroughly. So we do have a new system of records to record statistics that's being developed, clearly given the sensitivity of the nature. As I mentioned in my original remarks, this isn't held in the main system for all staff to see, but is held sensitively for only those that are dealing with these issues to be able to see that, and they will be able to monitor that and report up to the executive team as required.
That's really helpful, Cabinet Secretary. I appear distracted during your reply, it was because you wanted to check the name of a project, and you'll see that's not very professional. But I'll tell you why I was looking at my phone, Cabinet Secretary, because I invited a project to Parliament last week called Financially Included, and the name just escaped me, and they deal with economic abuse of women, and they support women to escape that economic abuse and put their finances back on track after having suffered that. And I was very interested to hear what you said there about about that kind of abuse and exploitation. Is there any more you can say about how this could help women in particular just now on the record? Or perhaps you could contact the committee. I'm conscious that 16 days of activism against gender-based violence and economic abuse is a key part of that. And if this addresses some of that, it would be quite nice to get some of that on the record this morning. So apologies for that distraction there, but I just wanted to check I had my details right about the question I was about to ask Cabinet Secretary.
So, Doris, I just thought I'd lost you halfway through my answer, but that's fine. I think I've actually met and visited the offices of the charity that you speak about. I noticed you'd had an event and had hoped to come down to meet them again, and I was very impressed by the work that they do and very pleased to see that being recognised within the Parliament as well. While I was on that visit, we spoke in great detail about the real concerns that we should all have around abuse being seen in the widest sense, and that to include aspects around financial abuse. And that's why we're very clear in my opening remarks about the need for us to recognise all abuse, including financial. That clearly is a concern for many different demographics. Clearly, the committee will be aware that there's concerns raised, particularly perhaps with older clients and financial abuse towards them. But also, you quite rightly mentioned, Mr. Doris, the aspects around domestic abuse and financial control being part of that. So I would very much hope that this would be something which would be able to assist those women in those types of situations if agency staff ever came across that.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thank you. And I wonder if you could say anything about how clients would be informed, should be informed that their information might be used in this kind of way.
So one of the reasons for having these regulations is to make sure that we're not working on the interim measures which I spoke about, but we are being very transparent about what's in place. Clearly, we have data protection and privacy notice statements that are attached on the gov.scot website, and that makes clear that we will share information, and it does include mention of safeguarding, so that clearly states the fact that information will be shared in very specific circumstances where there are safeguarding concerns. Clearly, as all committee members will be aware, the sharing of information is exceptionally sensitive. There has to be a great deal of care to make sure that's done lawfully. That's why those statements are made as people go through application processes, where it's, of course, not possible to ask a client's consent for their information to be shared. This does still allow for that to happen, but it's important that we do that because, of course, as we've just mentioned in the discussion with Mr. Doris there may be coercion, there may be aspects where a client is not able to give their consent at that time, and we are still obliged to ensure that we are sharing that information with all the care and sensitivity that committee would expect the agency to have at that point. Mm-hmm.
I mean, I have to say my reaction is very positive to this because I think there is a problem out there that we need to address. Can you say anything about how it might interact with power of attorney? Because would it be the person who holds the power of attorney who would be informed or consulted? But, of course, there's a risk that they are the ones that are carrying out the abuse.
Or perhaps bring in one of my officials, if they'd like to.
Yes, when it's actually the client, and I'd imagine in the case where the power of attorney... just for clarification, would the power of attorney potentially be the person committing the abuse against the client?
Well, frankly, I think that happens because there's very little check on people with power of attorney.
Yes.
But in a sense, that's a separate issue. But it could be either.
Yes. I think in most circumstances, the provisions in the regulations include where the power of attorney is the person committing the abuse against the individual, in which case that would also be one of the points for referral. If it was financial abuse or property abuse that the power of attorney was committing or alleged to be committing against the client, then that would be a referral to the public guardian under the new provisions. If it was neglect or physical and emotional abuse the power of attorney was alleged to be committing against the client, then that would be a referral to the local authority under the new provisions. If it was a suspicion of someone else committing an abuse against the individual. Camilla, would you be able to advise if that would be... We wouldn't seek consent from the power of attorney to be able to do that, although they stand in the shoes of the client?
Yes, I mean, the power of attorneys are regulated under the Adults with Incapacity Scotland Act, which in turn have the overseeing body, the Office for the Public Guardian. So there's a route to sharing with the Public Guardian in the case of the public... In all cases where the power of attorney is involved with a client, whether they're the person accused of financial abuse, or in the case where there is a power of attorney and there is someone else potentially causing the harm that would require the referral, the exact intricacies of who would be informed depend on the case in hand, but there are means of referring to the Office of the Public Guardian and to the local authority within the regulations. So those would provide the individual situations, depending on the exact circumstances, it would be a method of getting that information to a relevant authority who would then carry out further investigations and take any further actions as appropriate. These regulations are really essentially a power to share with the relevant authority, and it would be for that relevant authority then to use its own legislation and its own powers to carry out the investigation in more detail, depending on what's required. I hope that makes sense.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Katie Clark. Thank you.
And the regulations apply to a person with whom they, which is Social Security Scotland, have come into contact. So who other than clients would Social Security come into contact with, and how would they be informed about their information being used?
Perhaps maybe best to use an example in these aspects. If you can imagine a situation where an application has been made for child disability payment, you've clearly through that had contact with a parent or carer, for example, a member of our local delivery staff may be out there, have some really genuine concerns about not necessarily the child, but actually the parent or carer, maybe mental health concerns, whatever that may be, maybe a fear of domestic abuse. And it's that type of area where then I think it's very important that when we talk about dignity, fairness and respect, it's not just about the client, it's about applying that to everybody who the agency becomes in contact to. And in that case, that would be something where that local delivery member of staff would be able to come back and go through the processes that we've talked about to be able to assist the carer, the parent that may be in difficulty, even though they're not technically the client. So perhaps that kind of that type of example can bring out why it's very important to look at the situation which presents itself to that member of staff as they're going through a case.
And is there anything more you would say about how that information would be used, how they would be informed? What would the processes be? Would it be similar to the as you've previously outlined?
Indeed, it would be the same types of process. So, of course, there's an attempt to achieve consent, but if that consent, for the reasons we've gone into already, would not be appropriate or would not be able to be given, then that can still be done.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I believe Ros McCall wanted to come in, so apologies, Ros, but if you would like to come in now, thanks.
Yeah. Thank you. My apologies, Cabinet Secretary. I want to go back actually to Mr. Mason's question regarding how clients are informed. And from your initial answer, it was that actually everybody sort of signs up to that initial agreement that there will be information sharing. I think a lot of people in circumstances of stress will agree to a lot of things without fully understanding what that actually means. So in the case where there can be no explicit consent because of the circumstances already put out there, how does that individual know that this is happening in the background, in effect?
Well, they perhaps will not know that safeguarding concern has been raised and delivered to the local authority or the Office of the Public Guardian. And I think then, as Camilo pointed out, it would be up to those organisations to then deal with that in the manner that they would usually do. So I think, again, this is very specific about allowing an agency member of staff to be able to ensure that they have any concerns that they have dealt with in an appropriate process within the agency, and then there's the legal ability for that to be handed over to the relevant authority to then use their own powers, their own usual investigating manners, etc., to be able to look into that, and then that would be for those authorities to be able to determine what to do with that information and how to be able to deal with the individual concerned.
Okay, again, and excuse my ignorance on this, but we could have a situation where the first thing the client knows is somebody from social work turns up at the door.
In the case where the agency believes that that's the only way that that can be done, then yes, because they may, for example, fear that they will be making the harm worse and maybe allowing a perpetrator of abuse to actually have more power, more control, or more avenues for abuse because of the way that information is handled. So there is a sensitivity in this about, yes, dealing with the information, obtaining consent, but also being very careful about how you deal with that information, and that you could actually make an exceptionally difficult situation a lot worse if it's not done sensitively.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Paul Kane. Thanks.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to Cabinet Secretary. I think we've probably covered some of this detail, but are there other situations in where explicit consent wouldn't be given and that information would be shared? And obviously thinking again in terms of perhaps some of the adult or child protection legislation that is in existence and some of the interventions that often have to be made with other relevant authorities where someone wouldn't explicitly give their consent, but in terms of order to protect the public, that has to be done.
Yeah, so another example that's might be perhaps helpful is that consent is not required where a person lacks capacity to act. So, for example, around referrals to the Public Guardian, where people are covered by the Adults for Incapacity Act. I think I've mentioned that before. They cannot give consent. So that's one of the areas in that. The others we've probably touched on in previous answers. But as I said, the regulations do provide exemptions to allow for that sharing of information, specifically where it's viewed that there's reasonable cause to suspect that the individual is at risk of harm. And that's the important aspect that this always comes back to. So hopefully that gives another example of how this would be dealt with.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Marie McNair in, and that will conclude our questioning. Thanks.
Thanks, convener. I believe my question has been covered in the Cabinet Secretary's opening remarks. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. So I'm going to move on to agenda item four, which agenda item four is the formal consideration of motion S6M11172 that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Social Security Information Sharing Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024 draft be approved. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and to move this motion.
Moved, convener.
I now invite contributions from members. I invite John Mason to come in.
Thanks, convener. Just briefly, I mean, I think this is definitely a step in the right direction. I think there is a problem here with potentially financial abuse, and I think anything we can do to tighten up and protect people is to be very welcomed.
Okay. Would anyone else like to come in? Roz?
Thank you. No, totally behind the understanding behind this, and I think it's very important. I will always have a concern that the individual and the client in a lot of cases is circumvented in certain ways. That will always be a concern to me, but I accept wholeheartedly what's trying to be moved forward here, and I think it's very important that we do that, but there will always be a little question mark in the back of my mind that the individual still needs to be at the heart of everything that we do. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to sum up and respond to the debate.
Thank you, Convener. Very little to add. I would just respond to Ros McCall's point in that actually these set of regulations is an attempt to make sure that individual remains at the heart of everything that we do, because it is there a threat to harm on that individual is why we would take this, which we recognise is a very serious step of using these regulations. And I hope I can reassure her that is the intent of it, is to make sure that we are protecting some of the most vulnerable people in our society, some of which, just because of the circumstances, may not be able to give their explicit consent. But it is very much based on protection of those individuals that we seek to make these regulations today.
Okay, thank you. So the question is that motion S6M11172 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The committee will report on the outcome of the instrument in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. Are members all agreed? Okay, thank you. So can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and thank you to the officials as well. And that concludes our public business. We will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you very much.